Hello, hello, welcome to Quackalope, and today we're diving into Folded Wishes by B&B Games Studios, and today we're experimenting with a little bit of a different format of video. We're doing a series called Right For You, Wrong For You, where we break down six deciding factors that we use when we determine if a game is going to be joining our gaming library or not. Those six factors, which are all going to be linked in the description and comment section of this video, are the mechanics, the theme, the accessibility, the gameplay, the modes of play, how innovative a game is, and finally, if available, the price point. So, Jan, to start off, let's break down the basic mechanics of this game to let people know kind of what Folded Wishes is all about. This is an abstract, sort of shifting tile game where you're going to be using the powers on your tile abilities that are going to be modified by the cards you have kind of in your roster. You'll be placing a tile, shifting it up here on the top of the board, taking the resulting tile, resolving the effect of the tile that you placed, and trying to accomplish patterns. Just like folding origami, you're trying to manipulate this board so that you can do one of two things. The first thing, the way that you win, is by getting four of your colored meeples in a row.
Yep.
Whether that's diagonally, horizontally, however it can be, just like tic-tac-toe. That is hard to do, though, without upgraded powers. This card here indicates a tile-laying pattern that you could accomplish in order to unlock a special ability for every yellow tile that you place. And there's corresponding colors for green, pink, and blue, along with specific player powers based on which character you're starting with. So, this is an abstract tile-shifting game where the object of the game is to accomplish patterns that give you special abilities that allow you to get to your end goal, which is to sequence four in a row. This game can end at any point by someone accomplishing that final goal by getting four in a row. And oftentimes the balance point of this game mechanically comes down to how long do you focus on these pattern cards, these skill cards, versus how quickly do you start noticing that your opponent isn't paying attention and trying to get that pattern of four set up. So that's the mechanics of this game. If you're still tuned in, if you're still interested,
this might be right for you.
It might be right for you. Next, we're going to go into the theme. So, Jan, if you'll talk a little bit about the theme of this game.
Oh, yeah. So we are origami masters, and we're trying to come up with the most beautiful patterns and objects that we can with the tools that we have available. Each of these tiles represent a different technique of folding origami piece.
So we have a corner fold, a crumple, a mountain fold, a switch patterns, and a swap shapes. Those are actions that you can take throughout the course of the game. That's about as much as you need to know about them for this video.
Yeah, and essentially the board itself almost is like a piece of origami, or at least that's what the game is trying to convey.
Yeah. Along with that, every box includes origami paper, and we currently have prototype versions of the meeples. I do know that in the official print release of this game, the meeples are classic origami shapes as well. So, if you're into origami or you want to learn origami, every game will come with your own origami lesson, allowing you to fold and create the objects that you're actually playing with.
And if that sounds cool for you,
this game might be right for you. Next, we're going to take a look at the accessibility of this game. This game is, at first glance, fairly simple. It's a 15 to 20 minute game scheduled for 2 to 4 players, and on the box is billed for about 6 and up. I do think to win, it is a little bit more complex than that. You do have to pay attention to the skill cards, but as far as the rules and getting into the game go, it's not overly complex. This is one that you could teach in about 60 seconds, get to the table very quickly, and have a good time playing it with about any age range. So if you're looking for a game that is accessible and easy to get to the table that completes in a short amount of time, this game might be right for you. Now, talking about the gameplay specifically, Jan, touch on some of the elements that make this game right for you.
So essentially, if you enjoy chaining, if you enjoy creating combos that other players might not be really aware that are even possible on the board, this might be right for you. Essentially, the way that you bring in tiles into the game state essentially shift the landscape completely and allow for additional things to happen. So for example, you'll be able to move your meeples across this board in ways that nobody was really expecting, and suddenly completing a really that seemingly impossible pattern out of nowhere.
Now, that being said, it does lean on a point that might make this game wrong for you. The win condition can sometimes be a little bit deterministic on the player powers that different people have. Mm-hmm. So if you're not paying attention to other people's game states or kind of what they're able to do, you could have someone win sort of out of nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
It's why the game completes in about 15 minutes, but if you want to know all the information, but you don't want to pay attention to what the other person's kind of got in front of them, this game might not quite be right for you.
It's a quick playing game, so there's a certain level of attention that you can even give.
We'll move on to our next element, which is the modes of play. I've played this game in a variety of ranges. I do think that higher player counts are slightly more interesting because you get more manipulation on the game mm-hmm. state. I don't know what your sense of it is.
Oh no, for sure. I feel that the more things and the more meeples that are on each of these patterns, definitely there's a lot more intricacy and mm-hmm. a lot more complexity that adds to it. For two players, it feels a lot more like a thinking man's game, essentially, where a slight move here might be the difference between you winning the game and you losing the game yeah. when it's a little bit tighter.
It doesn't have a solo player.
No.
At two player, I don't know that it's one that I would grab immediately. Mm-hmm. It's not my favorite two player game. At three and four players, though, this game state does become fairly interesting because you have more time between your action and how this area shifts. And you also have more people paying attention to what other players around the table are able to do.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm playing with more people, I could point out that Jan's a move or two away from winning, and someone else might not have been paying attention to that. Because it does have a little bit of limited information based on what you're paying attention to, at two players, sometimes those victory conditions or those victories themselves can be a little unsatisfying for the player who lost.
Mm-hmm.
If you're excited to get this to the table with three or four players, this game still might be right for you. Let's take a look at our very next point, which is going to be innovation. What elements in this game, if any, stand out to you as innovative in this space?
I'm not sure if the right term here would be innovation, but I like the implementation of theme as to, you know, giving players the opportunity to learn about an art form.
Okay.
I think that's really nice, and I think it does it well throughout the representation and the actual paper.
I like the paper being included, the mm-hmm. lessons themselves being included. I do wish the game felt a little bit more like origami when it came to
folding.
When it came to mm-hmm. the like gameplay or the mechanics itself. It feels appropriate, but it doesn't quite feel tied in.
Mm-hmm.
That being said, including origami lessons and origami sheets, I think is really creative mm-hmm. and adds a nice touch or a nice depth to the experience of the game yep. as a whole. Outside of that, in terms of innovation, the tile slide mechanic isn't really innovative.
Yeah.
It is the most interesting part of the game.
Mm-hmm.
It is the core mechanic that you're playing with.
Mm-hmm.
But overall, I think this uses and implements standard game actions to make a interesting and kind of compelling game.
Yep.
If you're not too concerned about this being aggressively innovative, or you like the idea of having origami included in the box itself, kind of tying you back to that theme, this game
might be right for you.
It might be right for you. Let's go ahead and move on to our last point, which is gonna be price. Because
yep.
we're working with a prototype copy of this game, it is going direct to publication, direct to retail.
Mm-hmm.
We actually don't have a dial in at the price.
Yeah, but I think we can talk about what feels right for
I think
us.
That's fair, yeah.
I would say, I would put this either between the $20 to $25 range.
I was thinking anywhere between that $15 to $25 mm-hmm. range would feel good for this type of
yeah.
game. It's not deep enough, and it's not competing in a space where a price tag that's significantly higher than that would really sell me on it.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't regret picking it up around that price range.
Yeah, and I feel the only reason why I would say it's going to be closer to the $20 to $25 because mm-hmm. those custom meeples that are going to be shaped like origami, the way that I'm imagining it, does sound a little bit more complex than just a simple cut.
There's a little bit of customization in this game. Even the prototype copy that we have here, they're made out of wooden tiles.
Mm-hmm.
So for the quality to stay as high as the company would like it to be, which I'm sure they will end up doing, then I could see it being up in that $20, $25 range.
Mm-hmm.
I think you're right about that.
But anything beyond that, you would have to be a really big fan of Japanese culture.
You would need to go through and check off every one of our Right For You segments of this video.
Six out of six.
Now, if you've watched through this video to this point, I hope we're leaving you with a sense of whether or not this game is right for you or wrong for you. Please leave a comment in the comment section down below, letting us know kind of what you decided and if there's any way that we can refine this style of video to make it more appropriate to you and your personal gaming group. The context that we have over here is really Jan playing by himself in his basement, and so we're limited in terms of what we can determine.
Yeah, it's a bit of a difficult gauge.
Tell the audience. Either way, guys, thank you for joining us. Please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. And remember to do the important thing. Get out and play some games. We'll see you next time. Thank you.